Hi, everybody. Welcome to Alexis Hell Podcast number 7, numero 7. That was actually one of my ambitions, that I, all adverts on Spanish radio, done in this voice, talk like that. My ambition was, I used to do, and we talk about this in the podcast, actually, but I used to do advertising voiceovers, and my ambition, unfulfilled ambition, was to do a Spanish radio voiceover, like, disfruta Pepsi, numero uno bebida de España, or radio uno, numero Everything seems to be numero uno radio estación de España. That seems to be the limit of my Spanish. Anyway, it never came to happen. Today, a special treat for you comedy nerds, or I think. This is the terrible lie that is podcasting, that actually we've already recorded the podcast and I'm doing this first bit afterwards. Oh, man, I hope that doesn't undermine your sense of reality. Well, what's real and what isn't? I interview Stewart Lee, or it's really a conversation between me and, there are very, very few people that I admire in comedy. And Stewart is genuinely one of them. I think he's an extraordinary talent. And he's somebody who's also, in a way, been on an arc, really, that he was, you know, he was big in telly, and then he kind of, everything kind of went away. And then he, over many years, he built it back until before lockdown hit. He was an enormous, he was playing really long tours and big venues. And I really admire the way he kind of built himself back. Anyway, so this is a long and rambling, but I think really I found it interesting while I was doing it. I hope you enjoy it as well. So this is Alexis Hell Podcast number 7, me and Stewart Lee.
Well, you've also gone in a room that isn't full of books, so that's why it's echoey at your end.
Yeah,
they create a natural baffler, but you're sort of sitting in an echoing chamber of glass and stone.
Yeah, you know. Yeah, yeah. You can see that. That's a Terry Frost over my shoulder. You know the
art. Is it?
Yeah, it's a Terry Frost.
Well, I know his son, Anthony.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, because I met him through sort of Fall fandom. I like the band The Fall, and he did sleeves for them. He did about 3 record sleeves for them, and I always go and see him when I'm down in Cornwall.
Terry Frost did, or Steve did?
No, Steve did, yeah.
All right.
Yeah. It was great. I got him to take the kids around his studio, so they got to see what an artist was like.
Of course, also, Steve was also, of course, an Oblivion boy, wasn't he? Do you remember when they
Steve Frost, yeah. Anthony Frost.
All right.
Anthony Frost.
Terry Frost.
Yeah. Terry Frost's got 3, well, might have 4 sons.
Are we talking about somebody completely different then?
Yeah, Anthony the artist.
This is great podcasting.
Yeah. Do you want to start it again?
Yeah, we'll keep it. But Steve Frost, the comedian, is the son of Terry Frost.
He doesn't paint.
Right.
But Anthony Frost is the son of Terry Frost as well.
Okay.
You can have more than one son. You know, you can have more than one cat as well. We've got 3. You can have as many.
I've been a Maoist. I stick to Chinese rules. Yeah.
It's good. We're a minute into your podcast and you've said something that only you would say. It's what makes it different to all the other podcasts. This is what people are tuning in for, a Maoist interpretation of cat ownership.
Yeah. One male cat. That is indeed what I have. Yeah.
Are you looking round to see it?
See if he came up. Yeah.
Yeah.
You might come up later. So it's okay. Terry
but
Frost.
It's audio anyway. It's audio.
That's true. Terry Frost, the father of both Steve Frost and Anthony, this supposed Anthony Frost that you say exists. Although I have no memory. Well, you say he does, you know. Could be some kind of situationist prank.
But yeah, there's even more of them, but I don't know them.
Because the only one I know is Steve, who was the Oblivion boy who used to, of course, probably the finest lager in the world and all that.
They were more than that. When they were unlucky, it's that sort of thing, isn't it, where they had a little period where despite all the things they'd done, they were best known to the average person as the Carling Black Label blokes.
And Carling Black
they
Label,
would get it shouted at them in the street all the time. As, yeah. I don't think it would matter so much now because artists' ways of making money have been sort of stolen off them by various internet companies. I think people doing an advert now is... When I hear a band that I like doing an advert, it used to disappoint me and I'd think, oh, God, what a shame that's being taken away from me. Now I think, wow, you'll get paid rather than getting 1.0000 pence on your download. You might get some money. Yeah. But, yeah, you said that people just used to shout Carling Black Label at him in the street all the time.
Yeah.
We were not in adverts, but you did voiceovers for
I them, did, what, me? Yes. The line I chose very early on was the line not to cross was that I would never appear in an advert because that had a an element of endorsement, but I would do voiceovers, which is a marvelous example of kind of Marxist self kind of hypnosis, isn't it? Really, of lying to yourself about what's bourgeois kind of delusion.
We all make those sorts of.
I suppose
we
you
all
do.
Make those sorts of choices. I've just done one where I would never want to do anything for Sky because of Murdoch and everything. And I also thought things should be, accessible to the public at whatever. And I also thought it was weird when there were Coogan, for example, was selling stuff to Sky at the same time as he was trying to sue Murdoch. It just seemed really weird. But then this film that I worked on with Michael Cumming, who's also got a Terry Frost actually in his flat, King Rocker, we were supposed to take it round cinemas. We had to try and make all the money back because we didn't get anyone to help us with it. Everywhere had closed, and Sky were the only broadcaster that were excited about it. And I thought, well, Murdoch's got a minority shares now. It's not my money. I've got to make it back for other people. So I kind of did it. And actually, it's been great because Sky Arts was accessible to everyone now, free, and they're making... They've done a documentary about Ivor Cutler. You know what I mean? It's the sort of thing that used to be on BBC Four and is now the crumb of art from the Sky table. It's sort of bigger than the feast of BBC Four. So you kind of think, what are you going to do? You know, I don't know.
I agree, but it's a sad world where we have to. These are the things you battle with if you want to be. Reach a number of people. And also it's an interesting link into your film, King Rocker, which you've been on. That's actually the reason I think you said you never did podcasts before, but it was only through plugging. And I'm very, if I didn't have one, I wouldn't have anything to do with the fucking.
Well, I didn't know what they were either because I'd only been on Richard Herring. So I thought a man just talked about himself and didn't research your career at all. And then I've been on loads, and I have realised they can be whatever people want them to be.
Yeah,
I like this Marxist angle of this one. it's very different to Jay Rayner's, for example, which is about food. So I've realised now there can be all sorts of things. But yeah, I bit the bullet. I thought I can't not join in with the 21st century. I need to sell this. I need to get people to watch this thing. And obviously, the normal thing that I would do. It's go around the country in circles, playing to people, and then selling them things after gigs. But that farmer's market approach to entertainment that I have has gone, So I thought I've gone, but it's been great actually because we can't see anyone, so I get to talk to people. Which is nice,
It's a really interesting film. Linda couldn't watch it, really. I mean, not because of the quality, but because she's very, my wife is, she is very affected by the idea of wasted youth, or not exactly wasted youth, but, vanished youth, really. She cried, the Ron Howard Beatles documentary, 8 days a week, she cried all the way through that, really, because she'd been right at the tail end of the Cavern, so she'd seen them at the Cavern and stuff, the Beatles.
Yeah.
But also just that idea of how gorgeous and... young they were, and how that's all inevitably vanished. Really, I would quote a Shropshire lad now if I if I could remember it, which I can't. But
did she feel that the eye had decayed? Is that why she couldn't watch it?
Yes, she was looking at the terrible, terrible ravages of time that had wreaked on you since we first met you. Yeah,
it was only about 5 years ago. It's been a hard few years, isn't it? It's been a hard few years. What you look like now suits your persona now.
Yeah.
Totally. And people are lucky when that happens. You know, they're lucky that you're not thinking that's not Alexei Sale, the kind of who looks like a weird mod in a too tight suit in 1979. You're thinking this is Alexei Sale, who's now like this philosopher Marxist comedian people are lucky that they can grow into what they are. Other people grow away from it, and then suddenly the thing that they do doesn't work for their appearance. I mean, I need to lose a bit of weight because I'm slightly too fat now to do my act, and I haven't worked out the act that a fatter man would do. I haven't got time to do that under lockdown. I've got to come back with the sort of thing I was doing 2 years ago when I was about 2 stone lighter.
Right, yeah,
it's been a hard lockdown. But so there is a thing. But yeah, you're lucky in that it's sort of, you know, no one's looking at Alexei Sale and thinking, oh, he's not that handsome man from 1979. That you sort of totally suit this.
Well, thank you. Yes, you know, I agree. But also, it's also because one of my, you know, appeals, I think, when I'm doing live stuff is the fact that I am, that you see this elderly fat man, but because I'm also very physically fit, that I'm bouncing around, you know, and that's something that only I can offer, really, the combination of, you know, it's a kind of a Victorian special act, isn't he? Fatty McGrew.
Do you know, there was a jumping comedian, J.W. Stead.
I did not know that. Tell me about J.W. Stead. He wasn't Springfield Jack, was he, as well?
No, that was a murderer.
No, Springfield Jack, I think, was a phenomenon of mass hysteria in the Everton.
Yeah, in the end, yeah. Well, J.W. Stead, his act was he jumped up and down really fast. And in fact, if you buy a little doll to this day that you pull a string and it jumps up and down, it's normally got a pointy hat on it and it goes like that. Yeah. Little wooden puppet. That's based on J.W. Stead's stage costume. And he was sort of pitied by the other comedians because he was thought that he hadn't done very well. He lived in Bayham Street in Camden, and that's where he died. And at his funeral, all the other comedians, this is about 1908 or something, had a huge whip round for him, for his family, because they thought he'd died in poverty because he lived in a really rubbish place and he never spent any money. And they raised loads of money for them. Then after he died, he found he just hidden loads of money and they all wanted it back after he died. But J.W. Stead, I always think of him as I go along Bayham Street in Camden.
Yeah.
The house he lived in is not there anymore. I love that about that period of comedy
What did his act consist of? Just bouncing
up and down.
That
really
was it.
Fast. Yeah. Basically,
there really was no telly then, was there?
J.B. Priestley wrote about how great it was.
Really?
Yeah. I know that the older he got, the funnier it was, because he was really struggling by the end.
Well, that'll be me one day, yeah.
He didn't even have speaking, or he didn't have a Marxist angle like you.
Oh, really?
He just jumped up and down, and he offered no answers or commentary. He just jumped up and down.
I know there was crazy legs act. I didn't know just jumping up because there was a lot of. I mean, that was a subcategory of special, wasn't it?
Keppel and Betty sort of.
I think I might be making this because you know a lot. But I think Jerry Lewis's dad was a crazy legs act, which was just mad dancing, with the legs kind of flailing. But I didn't know there was just reducing it to its kind of. I mean, that would he'd be at Goldsmiths College of Art now, wouldn't he? Doing that really?
Well,
I mean, that
this
would
is
be
the thing. I mean, when you read about the music, I'm sorry, we've gone off on a bit of a tangent. When you read about the music hall, you're basically looking. A lot of it is like a form of a working class surrealism, right?
Yes.
But because it wasn't written about in that way or taken seriously, it was thought of as this junk, this trash. But you read the descriptions of the acts. And there's some really insane ones and a lot of real social satire. But then that was the sort of beauty of the early circuit as well, isn't it? Which I came in at the end of, is we were under the wire. And once it starts to get taken seriously, like the shift from music hall to variety, people kind of notice it. and then it, you kind of are analyzed yes. in a way that reduces your freedom.
Yes. Well, I actually, in my, I'm struggling to write my third volume of memoir after the two successful best-selling blah, blah, whatever.
Yeah, well, they're very good. Yeah.
But one of the things that I write about is I suddenly, and this was before I was a comic myself, but I think everything changed when, what was the what was the dramaturg at the National Theatre in the 60s? Kenneth Tynan did a big piece in the Observer Colour magazine about Morecambe and Wise. And that, a serious journalist had never before, as far as I know, interviewed a Variety act. And he said like one idiotic thing he said was that, you know, Ernie is a straight man who's funny and Eric is a comedian. I can't remember. He did some ridiculous inversion anyway about... Ernie's a straight man who's funny and Eric... No, that doesn't make sense. I can't remember what it was now. But that was the moment when everything changed because, as you say, kind of the kind of middle-class exegesis had never before been focused on a Variety act and everything started to change from that moment, I think, really. And it's really kind of problematic in a way. So you just, you know, that I mean, and it's never really been examined, has it, that idea of like the musical and stuff as being a lot more than, you know, roll out the barrel and all that. You know, it's never really been touched on, has it?
Well, the problem we got is like obviously where a lot of the stuff was happening in the music hall is in the middle eight of the songs where they would do the patter. But that's the stuff that doesn't survive, you know, and it's all... I mean, but what you're saying about analysis, about 20 years ago, I got fed up that I kept reading comedy, journalism about comedy, and it was as bad as reviews of pop records were in the early 60s, where they would go, they'd review something like a Cream record, and they'd go, this has got a good beat to it, and it rolls along, and it was sort of, there's no understanding of it at all. And so when I wrote the first book that I wrote about stand-up, I tried to quite self-consciously introduce critical theory terms into it.
Right.
But slightly as a parody of me, as the idea of an educated man who wanted the credibility of the low art that he was doing. You know, he wanted it to be elevated. But now I sort of think, I don't really know whether it's good to talk about it. You kind of don't want them to know really what you're doing. And one of the great things about stand-up is... You know, a lot of what you do is like literature. It's the political monologues. It's all sorts of things, but it's presented as stand-up.
Yeah.
And people that wouldn't go and see those things will go and see you and really enjoy it. And likewise, a lot of mine is pretentious performance art. but it's not called that.
Yeah, but sold as light entertainment.
Yeah. And if I, you know, and I like the fact that people, all sorts of people come. I read on the internet that it's all Guardian readers, but I do get, there aren't enough Guardian readers in Britain to be my audience.
No.
Get more people coming than read the Guardian. But so you do get all sorts of people. And I know that if it was advertised as a man who has read Kafka brings performance art strategies to bear on the vaudevillian tradition, you know, people will go, I probably won't go to that. So I like the fact that we're sort of still
working. Well, I would always think backstage at, you know, the Oxford Playhouse or somewhere, I would very consciously think to myself that I was part of that vaudeville music hall tradition, you know, that I take great pride in that, really. Yeah, and obviously, you know, we're bringing something new and different to it, you know, innovative, but we're also very much part of it, I think.
I think of that all the time, and I find it really overwhelming. And I remember when I'm in the old theatres or I'm backstage, I try and find old bills and think who could have been in this dressing room. And at the Wolverhampton Grand, I realised that I was in a dressing room that had probably been occupied by Fred Barnes, who was called the Duke of Solihull, which was weird because that was where I grew up, Solihull. He was called the Duke of Solihull, turn of the 19th century. He was the first out gay comedian.
All right.
And he did a song called I'm the Black Sheep of the Family. And it wasn't about being a sheep, basically. And he caused a huge scandal by being caught kissing a sailor. And there was some official crime that involved corruption of the Navy or something if he did that.
Right.
He used to walk around London with a marmoset on a lead very flamboyantly. And then his life went a bit wrong and he ended up going round pubs in Southend in the 30s with a chicken on a lead, reminding people that he once had a marmoset. and trying to do little bits of his act for free drinks. It's really sad.
Yeah.
But I found, well, that, I'm in Fred Barnes' room, you know.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
I found a signed photo of him on the internet as I sat there and right. I ordered it. And I thought, and it's up in the toilet now. And I thought, this is just, it is amazing. I've got much more in common with Fred Barnes than the
well, also because that's one of the surrealists in Paris in the you know, the early 20th century. Not de Tocqueville. I can't remember what he was called, but he used to walk around with a lobster on a lead.
Right,
and people used to ask him why. He says he would say it doesn't bark and it knows the secrets of the deep.
Well, so, isn't that interesting that there's two people walking around with unusual things on leads?
Yeah,
at a similar time in history, but for totally different reasons. That's the kind of thing that would blow Adam Curtis's mind. That
it's getting round. He lives around the corner. Let's go and
you should
get
go and tell him to do a thing about things on leads.
Yeah.
Does it prove something?
Yeah. You know? Well, of course, one of them is, you know, I can't remember. I have forgotten his name. He was one of the, I don't think he did much art, but he was one. But anyway, he's obviously the one with the lobster is respected and, you know, mentioned in academic journals. And the only person who knows about the other guy is you. Nobody else in the whole world knows about him apart from you.
I don't know, I just got really into those blokes because, you know, Stoke Newington, you know, obviously you know Stoke Newington from your famous routine.
Yeah.
Well, that's where I live, and we've got a cemetery here that is full of the graves of 19th century comedians, and there seems to be more here than in any other cemetery I've ever been to. And that's how I got fascinated by that period and how all these people sound really interesting and it's not documented. Herbert Campbell is in Stoke Newington Cemetery. He has a huge marble obelisk, like Cleopatra would have, that is hidden in the overgrown bushes, and it has the word comedian carved onto it. No one knows who that
is. It's an album cover.
And the only piece of footage that has survived of Herbert Campbell is a minute of him eating loads of food really quickly.
That was his act.
I don't know.
Because I've got a vague idea that some German, I don't know, Etta Volkswagen once, but I can't remember.
Right.
Gradually had it
ground
up.
Not all in one go, though.
No, I think he had it ground up, but I think that, I don't even know whether that was like a musical act or art, or he was just ill. But I've just got a vague memory of a German who had in the 70s, probably, or 80s, Etta Volkswagen. It's like bit by bit, you know. As it could be done. And this is just going out to the readers. Don't try and do this, readers, particularly not with the new hybrids, because it's, you know, battery acid will.
Yeah, well, there may be some issue about car parts crossing borders now. Anyway,
yes, that's awesome. Oh, Brexit reference, boom.
Well, I'm the Brexit comedian. I don't know if you know. You're the Marxist one.
Yeah.
I seem to become the 10 minutes of material I did about Brexit out of the 15, 20 hours of stuff I've done seems to become endless memes on the internet that are sort of bombed down on people whenever it's discussed. I like all those old musical types. It's kind of interesting. John Mackay, who we know is a promotion that we both use, he told me his mother used to tell him about an amazing act she'd seen. I don't know when it would have been, the 50s, 40s, I mean, of a guy who, he was called the man who sings Danny Boy. And he would come out in a white tie and tails and start singing Danny Boy with his hands at his side. And gradually, over the 4 minutes it took him to sing Danny Boy, the audience noticed that his arms were getting imperceptibly longer until finally his hands were dragging on the floor and then he goes off. I think, what a great act.
Yeah.
The weird thing is, he probably did that 4 minutes.
Yeah.
10 times a week for 30 years.
Yeah.
And that was it. And it was always middle of the bill, or it might have been the thing that came on. They sometimes had a thing after Max Miller had blown the roof off at the end.
Just
someone would come on and
down.
Do like 5 minutes of something, you know. But I mean, I just think, and what I think is funny about that is when I started seeing our circuit in the 80s and I saw people like the Amazing Mr. Smith or the Iceman or these crazy acts, I thought, oh, wow, this is so new and exciting. And then you get a bit older and you realise that loads of things have been thought of and loads of things that I do that I thought I'd thought of.
Mm.
I see Beryl Reed doing it in 1955
She loved
something,
me, Beryl Reed.
Did she? You know what?
That's
because she'd do this thing in her act. She'd go, anyway, I was talking to my mother the other day. Well, I wasn't actually, because I didn't torture about this at all, but I need to put it in the story. And, yeah. and it was all kind of falling yeah, yeah. apart.
And she she's a marvellous yeah. actress as well, brilliant yeah. in Smiley's.
Did you know her?
Yeah, I got her in. I did a comic strip film called Didn't You Kill My Brother? And
oh,
she
yeah,
played
yeah.
my mother. And she was right, always right. inviting me to Honeypot's house on the Thames.
Yeah.
Because she really loved me. But she was one of them, you know, you had to get her, you had to film her before lunch, you know. And I feel I was a bit, you know, I was a bit full of myself really, and a bit, I would love to now go and talk to her and, you know, and I did really respect her as an actress, series. I mean, she's amazing in those
days. You know, sets, that's a great thing you said, I was a bit full of myself. I think of all the opportunities I could have taken to learn from people in the 80s, 90s and talk to them about.
Yeah.
You know, and I just thought, I just kept myself to myself, you know, and thought it was a different world. Barry Cryer, weirdly, is very good at trying to sort of.
Yeah, kind of allied those borders, isn't it? Cross over
yeah.
those.
Yeah.
No, well, I suppose it goes with it. I mean, in a way, it's both. I mean, it's good that we both acknowledge our, you know, we're doing
pleasantness.
yeah, pleasantness. But we're making amends now. Is that step 9 in the 12 steps and traditions of AA? You know, we openly acknowledge our failure and seek to make amends. You know, so at least we acknowledge that we did it once. But it's also, I think it's I wonder whether it's a function of being our kind of comic in a way, that you are full of arrogance in the early days, really. It's something you need to propel you, really. And then
I think you have to kind of cut yourself off from everything somehow at the start. I couldn't do the panel shows. It didn't suit me. But also not doing it meant that I wasn't in that world, you know, where you have to find positive things to say about stuff you don't really like.
Yeah.
That's one of the reasons I was worried about doing podcasts is it seemed to me, it seems like a strange world and Facebook and Twitter of people all liking each other. And if you go on someone's thing, then they have to go on yours. And it's this sort of mushrooming of connections.
Yeah.
And also it means that a lot of the podcast interviews have to be very anodyne because the person doing them wants to get on that person's podcast later on. I did one with Adam Buxton now, and he was quite critical of me. And you know, which I liked because it wasn't like one of those, you know, and then he sent me, Max Miller's autograph afterwards, actually.
Fucking hell, that's a gift.
I know.
That's a fucking muffin basket and a half, that, isn't it?
Yeah, I know. About that.
Yeah.
But I've got nothing to give him. No, I can just do.
You've been on his podcast. Richard Herring, you know, I mentioned to Richard Herring, which was just this thing that sustained me through last year, is that The Guardian said I was the best stand-up of 2020. And then my stand-up show, Brian Logan said, and then you know, Richard Herring pointed out that it was probably the only stand-up show of 2020. I thought it was a bit, you know, a bit cruel, really.
You were
working in 2020. I think you were in this list.
Oh, at the start, yeah. So I came down in March.
Yeah,
I
remember, me too, it was, yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
Have you got dates to finish off then?
Not really. I mean, my it's hard to know which bit of this conversation, if any, the podcasteries will like. But I had done, I think I was about like 27 day tour or something. I mean, tiny by your standards, but I was 2/3 of the way through it, and I'd just done 5 nights in Liverpool, and then lockdown hit that week when he said people shouldn't go to theatres. I mean, my feeling was that, I mean, initially that the venues, you know, just booted the dates into the autumn, and, you know, like I was supposed to be, you know, doing them dates last October.
Yeah.
And then in the end, I just said cancel the tour, really, because I can't, you know, I don't know what's going to happen with this. I can't think that I'm going to go back on the road, really. I just have to. And so the money was sitting in the venues, box offices, and they, as far as I know, just gave, it never came to me. So, or the promoter, they just gave the money back, really, rather than saying, than endlessly hanging on to the money and saying,
Well, yeah. I was sort of halfway through the last one. The second hour of it is about Dave Chappelle's rider, right? And that is unaffected by COVID, as far as I know. But the first half was sort of about the culture war, as it seemed in 2019.
Which is
a long time ago now, and it's going to need a real overhaul. But I think there'll be a real excitement if you'll see. I mean, I've left all that money with the venues, and we're trying to reschedule it, and I think it will. It'll be a big help to some of them if they're all there. I mean, some of them will close in the meantime.
I think so.
I think people can get a refund if they want, but people seem to have left it optimistically, thinking that they want to go out. And I think it'll be good for comedy. I think there'll be a real excitement for people to be in places and see things. And one of the weird things about that King Rocker film, which we never anticipated, was it's about music and comedy in the 70s, 80s, 90s, noughties. And you see a lot of film of people in packed little rooms watching gigs. And you see a lot of film of people in pubs drinking and talking. And you see a lot of film of people walking around in the countryside. And that seems like really moving to people, I think, at the moment.
So you're gonna whenever you can, which is going to be a fair old way off, I think. But you're going to remember.
I'll announce it soon. It'll be the start of next year, I think.
At the earliest. Yeah, no, I mean, I think I saw that your show. I saw it early on, I think, when you were.
Well, you know, it's got that big prop. Right. You know, I mean, I've got to. I've had to put that away.
You're giant. I won't give away what it is. Yes, Talal, so are you saying something?
Someone's got a TV on in the background or something. I can just hear this constantly.
I'll have a look and see if it's the kids. I might go and shut the door. They're doing schooling, obviously.
Oh, it's your kids,
And you guys are so chummy. It's really nice.
That's homeschooling. Sorry about that.
Oh, nothing to be sorry for at all. We get it, man. Thank you for that, Steve.
I did Owen Jones's podcast, which I know you did. He sent me an example. We didn't get on at all, really.
Owen didn't.
Yeah, I didn't. I don't know whether it's gonna. I don't know. I mean, I don't know how it will be when it comes out, really. But we're just talking about that while you were off mic. This is a lot more genial.
you're probably both more. Opinionated about politics.
It's one of the things, getting sucked into. I never, it's probably not the place to discuss it, really, but
he's a nice bloke, though, isn't I think.
Yeah, you see, if you've been dragged into the fucking mire of left Labour Party, Corbyn, I think some of his positions...
He's a pro Corbyn, isn't he?
He is, yeah, but damn you, Jeremy, for making me care, I was perfectly happy before, just hating everybody, and then Jeremy made me have hope.
You know, you said that about, you seem to fit, this seems to be a recurring theme in your life, anger at the idea of hope. Because in your book, you talk about leaving Liverpool as a working class kid to go to, going south to art school.
Yeah.
And feeling that you were given the impression that the society was on the move and social mobility was happening. And then, of course, that has not turned out to be the case in the way that the post-war dream imagined. And you seem to feel angry with that moment in time for suggesting things could be different. Then you were cross for 40 years, and now you're angry again because of Jeremy Corbyn.
Yeah, yeah. It's
Just stay in.
It's a wasted life, isn't it, really? When you think about it, when you put it like that, it's entirely, squandered, I think.
Well, I know what you mean. It's the possibility of things and then them not happening is dispiriting. But
yeah,
I felt weirdly confident about something the other day. I've been getting annoyed about how the sort of alt-right has tried to kind of weaponize comedy, and there's all these sort of acts now that go, "Are you triggered? Whoa, bad luck, snowflake." And I was thinking, is this, and now they've managed to create this victim narrative, as they would call it, whereby they have to be booked onto all comedy shows. Otherwise, it's discrimination against wankers.
Yeah.
But I notice a very young couple of comics. Well, they may be 35, but they look young to me on the internet.
Yeah.
Doing a sort of low-tech sort of parody of that. And I thought, oh, yeah, when the young people start to think it's ridiculous, then, you know, that's the next wave of stuff coming through. Just as the Tories are still trying to, like, go ban universities, they're full of left-wingers, put all the statues back, say yeah. slavery's good, just as they're trying to use all that to wind everyone
yeah.
up.
Yeah.
It looks like there is young people coming through that have seen through it, this fabrication of controversy.
Right.
And
right.
I mean, you know, you have to be careful, and I say this as someone about to be 53, but you have to be careful not to think there's no hope, you know.
Yeah. See, I put my hope, I think, in a kind of environmental collapse and a kind of rise of Mad Max dystopias, you know, some of which yeah. will inevitably be socialist.
Well,
you know, that's my hope. Yours is a lot yeah. more genteel than mine.
Well, David Davis told us that we didn't need to worry that Brexit would lead to that. I remember him saying specifically, Brexit will not lead to a Mad Max style dystopia. And you seem to be rather hoping that it would. But
yeah.
that, again, is that Marxist model, isn't it? Of the you have to destroy society
yeah. Yeah.
and then rebuild it from the ruins rather
yeah.
than thinking it can be gradually transformed.
Marxist dialectic, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
And, you know, the chance for me to, yeah, get my hands on a shotgun. All that, really.
What clothes would you wear in a Mad Max style dystopia?
That's an interesting question. Thank you for that, Stuart. Because obviously the sort of the fingerless leather gloves and the kind of combat trousers and the high lace is a bit kind of cheesy, isn't it?
Oh, yeah.
That's one interesting thought.
I've seen you on your bike cycling around under lockdown. So would you customize that and put horns on it and things and spikes, or would you have a motorbike? But then you have to get the fuel from somewhere, wouldn't you? You know, the dystopia.
There's a film that we used to watch when we were called Lenin in October. Lenin in October, which is about the October Revolution, and it's quite avant-garde in a way. And there's a huge meeting of Bolsheviks, and a bloke comes through the door and he says, "Comrades," and they all look, turn around, and then they repeat the scene again. He comes through the door again, he goes, "Comrades." And they all look, ugh. And then he comes through the door a third time, goes, "Comrades," and then he shouts, "The bicycle brigade are with you." And then you see this shot of these bicycles, hundreds of bicycles, armed bicyclists, hurtling yeah. down the road. I always found that profoundly moving, really, because it's a kind of elision of revolutionary politics and bicycles,
yeah.
two of my
yeah.
interests. So, yeah, I suppose you could, yeah, I'd like to get like a mat. Yeah, you could have a mount for an assault rifle or something, couldn't you customize? Whether you'd lay it along the top tube or whether you'd have it like the way cowboys used to have their Winchester rifles, sort of. You'd have to make it so it wouldn't.
You need to be careful, right? What you're talking about, because what will happen now on the internet is this will be decontextualized, and this little bit will be taken out, and it'll say Marxist comedian plans massacre of. Of innocent civilians.
I have to say,
you know, he's sitting at home in his room with his cat, thinking
yeah.
how he can mount an assault rifle on a bicycle. You know, you can't really afford to make these kind of jokes
really
out of the context of the comedy club now, or even in the comedy club, or even think them.
Really?
Do it.
That's sad.
But I look at you saying that and I think, well, that's the next show, isn't it? Look, it's called Alexi Sale Looks Forward to a Mad Max Style Dystopia.
Yeah.
You know, and then.
Yeah. Because I did used to have a shotgun. I had a shotgun. So can I reveal that? I had a 12-gauge Lambert, and I gave it up, really, because Linda was... Because at dinner parties, I'd get drunk, and then Linda would shout, "Don't get the shotgun out." And I would inevitably... It was in a set. I would get it out the safe where it was, and I never loaded it, but I would sort of wave it around. That was a feature. When we had drunken dinner parties in the 90s, that was a facet of it would be Linda shouting, "Don't get the shotgun out." Is that, I don't know, is that...
well, is that, you know, it's your podcast. You can put that out if you want. I haven't got an anecdote to match that, if you're thinking I'm going to now say, I have a concealed weapon in a cupboard. And, you know, at dinner parties go... And put the AK-47 back. You know, we don't have dinner. But I've never had a dinner party ever. I don't even know how. I spent my whole 20s sort of working every night, and my 30s. And then when I got to the age where you're supposed to have dinner party, I've been to two. Three, I think I've been to, yeah. And I never know what to do. I don't know what you're supposed to do. I find it just does my head in. I don't really understand it. I like talking to people in pubs and stuff.
Yeah.
I don't mind eating in a pub.
Because that was the centre of kind of the bourgeois arts of the sort of 70s, 80s, 90s was the depiction of the kind of middle, the bourgeois dinner party was.
Yeah.
And so you're missing out on a huge tranche of kind of bourgeois.
I did see one actually, oddly, where Owen Jones lives.
Yeah.
I was walking around Islington and I saw through a window loads of people that looked like TV producers and lecturers and things, all sitting round a table, eating and drinking wine and laughing. And I thought, that's what they, in the paper, when it goes, is this the kind of thing that is discussed at an Islington dinner party? Yeah. I wonder what that even is. I thought, that's exactly what Rod Liddell is thinking about when he he uses this imaginary thing. And there was a real version of it. And I looked through the window like an urchin. For a bit, thinking that's where all the people I'm supposed to.
Did you want to be there, or did you just feel it wasn't, it wasn't for you, really?
No, it wasn't for me. I'm deaf a bit. I'm a bit deaf, and all people talking, it's just I can't.
Because there would have also been, if you'd been inside that dinner party, there would have been sexual tension. One of the men would have had a previous affair with one of the women. Or one of the other men, or there would be undercurrents of.
That's always something.
One of them would be pro Corbyn, would hate the other secretly, but wouldn't be able to mention it because they felt that they had failed in their. It was their one chance of socialism. Well, he wouldn't say this, but that'd be a kind of part of the be repressed anger there, and then
I know.
The food would be, the drink would be. Yeah, Alison's. So I've been to four
dinner parties. I went to one in about 2001 when I was working at Battersea Arts Centre with some of the theatre people from there.
Yeah.
But I left early. It started to get a bit. You know.
Yeah.
Then my neighbours had me round, but they've gone now. But they used to have dinner parties with loads of people every weekend, and that was all right. But I couldn't get them back. I can't cook that kind of food. I make like pasties and shepherd's pie and things. And then I went to one which was nice with a bloke that used to work for the Guardian and a bloke who works for the European and their partners, and that we had scallops. That was nice. But again, I can't. And then I went to my sister had one once, my half sister, and I was there anyway at their house and they had a dinner party. I just turned up and I got invited to that. Well, I've been to four, but I couldn't ever have anyone round.
Yeah, well, then they won't, because you wouldn't have them back, the couple from there.
I'm excluded.
They won't invite you back because they're like, fuck Stewart Lee. Well,
no, they were great. They're really nice people, but I just I cook like Sunday roasts or shepherd's pies, or we made pasties yesterday. I don't make that kind of small food with coloured juice on it. And then everyone looks at it. And also, I don't know about you, right, but I find it very difficult. If you mainly know comedians, okay, you get into the habit of saying really stupid things that are not meant to be taken seriously.
Right.
And you can't do that. I've realised you can't do that.
Yeah.
Because the only people I know, I only know about three people, really.
Yeah.
Kevin Eldon, Ben Moyes, comedian stroke performer. I know two people, basically.
Yeah.
And, like, when, if you say something like, okay, these things haunt you forever. Like, there was a thing in the school playground where all the kids had to make a model of some island or something. And one, there were seven, and one had brought one in. It was museum quality, It was not the work of a seven-year-old.
Yeah.
And one of the mums went, oh, that's good, isn't it? What's this map? And I went, well, he obviously didn't make it. His parents have done it. They should smash it up and throw it out. It's not acceptable. And it was like, and everyone was really freaked out.
Yeah.
And I just thought, well, anyone else that I know would, you're kind of unfit for purpose. Right?
Yeah.
The things that you get paid for, you get paid for behaving inappropriately and saying stupid things. And those same things, believe it or not, are a hindrance in life.
mean, I've literally been to thousands of dinner parties, I would think, really. So that's what we don't know.
Yeah, I know. Good.
One thing, when it was briefly legal in, and you, I don't know whether this will help you, during the coronavirus, when it was allowed, we stopped you. You know, you grow out of dinner parties. But one of the things, we would know, but one of the things that I started doing really was having drinks and nibbles. So a couple would come round at, say, 5:30, and we would have wine, and I'd do, you know, maybe a cheese platter or, you know, meats, a cold collation.
Yeah. I've missed the window. The point in life where I would have learned how to do that has gone, you know, in this cave of physical media and books. And I don't, you know, I just did gigs all the time for 30 years.
Yeah.
And I realised when I came out, you know, into lockdown, I realised I'd missed loads of weddings and, you know, all these sorts of things, and to try and be this thing, you know.
Yes,
I was around for the kids.
Yeah, because I've never really lived that life that you've. I mean, I did. You know,
you stopped
years in the early. I stopped. Yeah, and then even when I've gone back to it, it's been. I mean, compared to the scale that you do it, a tiny amount, really. So yeah, hasn't that been a terrible? I mean, just a real. I mean, to be suddenly at not gigging for you must be like really.
It's
weird.
Awful. It's like you know what? It's not. It's not awful in the way that someone losing their job is. Let's not be that person that says that. And it's not. It's not. But it's. But I think that. You know, I've never bought into this psychology of comedian stuff. But I think if you were as busy as I am. And then you'd finish one tour and then write another 2-hour one and think, when can I get that? You're blocking something out, you know, or you do, it is true, the cliche that you need the approval of these strangers, and having that withdrawn, you know, it was probably creates some sort of chemical alteration or imbalance, but it's a luxurious problem to have. I'm not, you know, I haven't got to get furloughed or anything, you know. Yeah. The tour came down halfway through, but it's interesting. And then you start to wonder who you are, really, if your personality is continually formed by being in these high stress situations where you're trying to win the approval of thousands of people at the same time as appearing to hold them in contempt.
Yeah.
And what does it do for you?
Yeah. Yeah. And have you resolved, you know, in future to be better at kind
of... I don't know. I mean, you know, the worry is when we all have to start again, do we know who we are?
Yeah.
And do the audiences know who they are? Do they remember what they were supposed to do? Because they have an act as well, don't they? They have a sort of thing that they do. Yeah. It's interesting. And also, you know, how important will people enjoy someone complaining trivially about how Dave Chappelle's rider is much bigger than anything they would ever have?
Yeah.
Or will that just seem just irrelevant in the scale of death and failure that we're, you know, going through? Well, I don't know. It's an exciting time to be doing it, you know.
Yeah, because
you know, going back to the old, sorry, go on.
Because I've got a series of radio plays coming out in March, really, and I did a kind of associated article for Radio Times, and I just was musing in the article about whether you should try and write about now or whether you should just, and I did, I mean, all of, I think one set in Liverpool in 2007, one set in a kind of modern, in Spain, kind of pre-lockdown, but also in during the Blair years, and the other two are set kind of, you know, in 2019 or something, but I didn't want to really address directly. And I think that's the right, you know, set something in the pandemic, you know.
Well, yeah, but your bike ride YouTubes they're about the pandemic, aren't they?
I suppose, yes, they are. I never thought they about are. It. Yeah, I never actually gave
any. I mean, there'll be an interesting record of empty London. I mean, I've been doing loads of walks under lockdown, and I've got an idea that it might be a book of walks around London book, but the subtext being that the person writing it is having a hard time, you know, thinking of things to occupy them.
Oh, right. Yeah,
but, you know, but I used to love it. In the first lockdown, where it was completely empty, I used to walk from Stoke Newington to a pub in Covent Garden opposite the Freemasons Temple that was open. Yeah, and it used to serve through the window.
Right.
They give you a plastic pot, and you had to stand more than 100 yards away from the pub. There was some, and so the square in Covent Garden, where all the Freemasons pubs are, was full of just men standing on their own. And then at 10:30, or with a friend at a 2 meter, at 10:30, the landlord came out and called last orders to the whole square of like men standing around. And actually, I did it two or three times, and I have very lovely memories of the quietness of it. But this lockdown's not like that. The first lockdown, I walked all around where you are, that big square where the orphanage was.
Should have called in.
And it was incredible with the emptiness of it. Just like science fiction stuff. But that, you know, but your bike things.
I hadn't really thought about it in that. I need you to do the academic analysis of what I'm actually doing. I just thought, I'm just riding out on my bike talking to myself. I hadn't really, you know, put it in a kind of historical context, you know, which thank you for doing that.
It'll be one of those things that's interesting to look back on.
It's a loud idea because when we met to he's doing my technical stuff because when we had a meeting about doing this, I arrived on a bike and he said we should do a bike thing. So yeah, right. Yeah, and I do like them. I think I like watching, even though I've done the bike ride. I like watching it, really. I wouldn't listen to my podcast, but I like watching the bike ride.
I'll
listen to him. I mean, I might.
You're like Gerald Ratner, you are, aren't you? He wouldn't buy his own jewelry. The Gerald Ratner of Marxist podcasts.
Yeah, I'm not going to listen to it. Well, no, I'll listen to it. You know, review it in case. What you said. But also, I went for a walk in Waterlow Park with my producer Joe Nunnery on Saturday, and then we bought a couple of cans of lager and we went up to Pond Square in Highgate, and the square was full of people who would formerly have been drinking in Shoreditch House or the Groucho Club, and they were standing around like fucking tramps drinking lager or rosé.
I've really noticed that happening. When I walk around here, I walk through the squares around Dalston, and all the usual street drinkers are there.
BBC commissioner.
Over sort of near Sadler's Wells, over that way, you see in the middle class squares with the Victorian villas.
Yeah,
with you see these pockets of people standing around drinking wine. Yeah, it's basically made everyone.
Yeah, Darcy. Everybody's a street drinker now.
Drinking
Buckfast Lee. On a corner. It's weird, isn't it? I mean, they seemed happy to be there, really. And there's a little shop that sells Argentinian empanadas. There was a long queue for them. I think that's what they were. I don't know. But it was, it's funny how it's funny how it's affected shit, yeah. Yeah, well, I suppose, yes, I suppose the bike rides are and I do like them. I think that they're very original. You know, they're an interest. I'm surprised more people haven't done it, really, but it seems an unusual thing, really. We're thinking maybe I should plan them a bit more because I don't know where I'm going when I set up.
There's lots of weird, strange, unknown people living all around that part of town where you are. I keep finding out about as I wander about, you know. Artists that you realise you vaguely know, and people that thought they could call up the devil, and all kinds of strange people. It's a fascinating bit of town.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It looks a bit like I didn't really think about it, but Talal did like a wide shot in the latest one where you see he focuses on my trainers, which are covered in mud because I'm walking every day on Hampstead Heath or Highgate Woods, and then he does like some, and it's no point in cleaning your shoes anymore because they're all covered in mud. And then, I mean, do you walk the streets rather than the kind of faux, kind of rural?
Well, you know what? And last year, I really made an effort, and I was doing about 30 miles a week trying to get out, and I was planning these routes, and but this year I just can't motivate myself. So yeah, I found the streets really interesting. But I was up on Hampstead Heath the other day. I found that Neolithic Bronze Age burial chamber they've got there of called Boudicca's grave that I never knew about. And then I went to that garden, the pergola, the Hampstead Hill garden, the other day.
Incredible.
And I can't believe I lived here 30 odd years and never seen those things. I mean, that's one of the things lockdown's done, is it's thrown up all these strange things about London that I never knew about. And I'm ready to leave now. I never thought I would be. I'm ready to go. I've had enough.
Really?
And this is, yeah.
Are you going to go?
This is,
I don't know. You're going to go to Hastings? You're going to live in Hastings?
No, the Forest of Dean, I think. Forest of Dean. If we can work it all out.
Oh, because that's somehow where it's from. And that's where Dennis Potter was from, is that right?
Yeah, Dennis Potter, yeah.
I spent 6 weeks in Helsinki with Dennis Potter.
Did you?
Yeah.
What was that? What are you working on there?
Because he did the script for Gorky Park, my first movie.
Oh, right. Yeah. He did the script for that, and you were in Helsinki.
Yeah, shot in Helsinki because you couldn't get into what was then the Soviet Union to film.
Yeah.
And he was there because he did a rather poor job, I think, on the script. And he'd be in the bar every night. He was a very unhappy man, really. But again, I wish I'd paid more attention. You see, I was like, I spent 6 weeks in Helsinki with Dennis Potter and took nothing away from that, really. You know what I mean? And he was like, because of full of that fairly youthful arrogance, really. And I think, wow, you know, I could have found out all kinds of things if I'd just thought, fuck you stupid old man.
Do you know what? So it's funny. I think partly the reason you're not targeted by people is because you say so many contentious things that could get you in trouble in every podcast that they become like white noise. I mean, normally a person on the left saying, "I thought, fuck you, you stupid old man," about Dennis Potter.
Yeah,
that would be a story in the Express, you know, or the Daily Mail. But it's just, there's so many things you're waving around your shotgun and everything. It's kind of like they can't pull them out.
They've never come for me. It's weird, isn't it, really?
Why haven't they come for you? Why do they come for basically people on that? They'll come for, they'll come for centrists. Like, I'm called a centrist, I understand. They'll come for people like me if we say something that they think is, I'm considered left-wing I'm considered a far-left person who has to be targeted and silenced by the right-wing sort of trolls. So why do they come for, why have you not been destroyed? Because you are an out-and-out Marxist, and you say you are, and you look forward to the Mad Max-style dystopia, and you've got a gun, and you're working out how to put it on your bike to just massacre people, and you've been horrible about Dennis Potter, who's a national treasure, and died tragically, and did a very moving interview about that with Melvin Bragg towards the end. You've poured scorn on him, and yet you sit there untouched by the... by the people trying to discredit everyone. How have you got away with it?
I don't know. It's special. Odd. I don't know. I don't know what it, yeah. I mean, I'm aware that is a phenomenon, really. Mm. Maybe it's because I'm fat and chubby and sort of look harmless or something. I don't know, really. I've been around so long. I think it's probably, I remember somebody telling me once that in France, if you get to a certain point, then you're a star, and it doesn't matter what you do. So if you rent the Olympia and then just vomit every night,
Julian Cope said that to me. You remember Julian Cope? He's still going and making really great records. But he said that about 10 years ago, he said to me, I'm not his showbiz friend, by the way. I've only met him like a few times. I'm not saying, but anyway, he said to me, I'm aware that at the moment I'm a has-been, but if I can get through that, I'll become a legend.
Yeah.
He is a legend now. And that's the thing, isn't it? And when I first met you, you were worried, and Linda was very funny about it. And it's a thing that a lot of people
abusing
think
us
about.
Weird about.
Pardon?
she was amusing about it, or she was just...
Yeah, well, she was, yeah, in a funny way. She was worried that you were that you would undo your own reputation.
Oh, yeah, by the legacy, yeah.
By
yeah.
returning to perform. Yeah. And, yeah. And yet you're out the other side of that now, aren't you?
Yeah, absolutely. You know? Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. It's I think that must be what it is, that I've been around so long that I've passed into that superstar. Yeah, that kind of area where I can do no wrong. Really, I think I can't be. I wouldn't like to test that too much. Really, I think this. But I think.
Do you think that if they put the first series of the sandwich bar out now, people would complain about it, because as of last year, one of the fabricated things from the right wing media, probably coming from some office in Tufton Street, is that there's too much left wing comedy, particularly on the BBC. This is a sort of made up story that was falsely attributed to the new director, Tim Davey, who in fact had said nothing of the sort. But that was never corrected. But do you think that do you think if it came out now? Because, I mean, there's bits in it where you do things like you'll say this really funny ad lib. I assume it's an ad lib. Well, it feels like it is, where something gets a particularly strong response, something to do with politics, and you go, when Jeremy Corbyn is elected, all comedy will be like this. And the audience are really laughing and cheering. And that's not to say they're necessarily Corbyn supporters or Labour voters or whatever, but they can see what is funny about that. And I think even a line like that, delivered with a sense of irony now, would be the kind of thing that would be snapped out of context and used to make out that there's this this thing happening.
Well, no, I mean, to be honest, no. I mean, Radio 4 has just been fantastic, really, to me. So, and they seem to be like the old, Radio 4 seems like, the old BBC that you knew in the 80s, really, which was fearless. I mean, I did this story on the podcast before, but when we did the first series of stuff, I had this idea, Snow White and the Seven Samurai, and Disney threatened to sue us, and we went to see the BBC barrister, and she said, fuck Disney, we're the BBC. And they were just very self-confident, really. And Radio 4, my experience of Radio 4 has been, I'd like to claim victimhood, because that is very much the spirit of the age. But, I mean, Radio 4 has been endlessly supportive to me. So I don't know. I think that, again, for whatever reason, they love Sandwich Bar, and they said, I can only write, probably because I write it all by myself, I can only do four, but they said, you do as many as you want, really. So now in that self-pitying scenario, no, it's not really, I don't know whether it's that I'm licensed in a way to, I think because, and this is really why I always shy away from activism, that when I do comedy, which is left wing, then it's always set about with self-doubt and self-criticism. It's inherent. Yeah. I mean, even that bit that you quote is obviously self-mocking in a sense. Yeah, and so it's fine, really. But it's when you get into that area where you're just relaying your opinion, then that's when all that goes,
That's the thing. I mean, I find myself, there are not many things that I laugh openly at unless I'm in the place, but Sandwich Bar makes me laugh listening to it on my headphones. And it's partly because in amongst all this stuff about the dialectic and whatever, they're just really stupid voices. Like all the people that you'd end up talking to from history just like sound like squawking sort of crows and monkeys and stuff. Or they have accents that are entirely inappropriate to whatever period of history area they come from, and no explanation is given for this. And there's that is weirdly, it connects it to me to a sort of Pythonesque sort of university satire sort of thing, or that kind of weird crashing together of history. So it's like it's sort of that's the difficult thing, is that they like to say it's not funny and people are just laughing because they agree with it. But the problem is, in the room, that's clearly not the case. People can't involuntarily be crying with laughter. They can't do that to order, And I think this is a huge source of frustration. I think the problem is that sort of critics on the right tend not, they're partly on the right because they don't have imagination, empathy, or a sense of humor. And that's why they're on the right, you know. And so they just can't get it. Like there was a review in the Telegraph of one of these Tufton Street people who also is a journalist, as if they were impartial in some way, of the new Adam Curtis thing. And she seemed to have misunderstood that it wasn't really a documentary. She was sort of criticizing it for failing to have supporting arguments and for not having proper archive footage in it. And it's not really, it isn't what it is, is it? It's a sort of bloke going, look at this, what about this? Well, yeah, that's weird, isn't it? Yeah. It's like a sort of ramble around someone's brain who's been locked in a cellar with too much archive footage. It's not meant to be panorama. So you can't really go, you know, it's biased or it doesn't make sense. And but they can't really understand that. And that's why they are who they are, you know.
Yeah, I think we do live in worrying. I mean, that assault on you know what we do, that nuanced thing that we do, there is an assault on it really, which I think is, I mean, that's why I'm so grateful partly to Radio 4 for, you know, seeing that in me. I think that it is dangerous really, but I think we're living through dangerous times in a way to be in our game. What do you think about that? We probably should wrap this up in a bit really, but I mean, I know you talked kind of
this is the most relaxed podcast I've done, by the way. I've gone from doing none to having done loads, and this is really just you're in your house, isn't it? And you don't seem to have any thought for the people listening to it as well. Sad in some ways. I mean, they're
not paying any fucking money really, in the way. That's one of the things which, because this is costing me money. This.
Is it?
Yeah.
Well, you can get people to, they'll give you a donation. I don't know how it works.
You've talked me into Lau. We're talking about that yesterday because we did originally think about doing advertising, but I'm sort of uncomfortable with that really. Yeah, so I think we might do a kind of.
You could hold up a little. Well, what things do you like to eat?
And advertise them?
Yeah.
What things do I like to eat? That's an interesting.
Isn't it like out of date pickle? That's something you like to eat.
Well, that's one of the things. Although people have, I found some noodles from 2001 last night, but I thought that was probably.
The problem you've got is in the current climate, is, say, Branston Pickle going to want to be associated with a man who is planning to carry out, live in a Mad Max dystopia with a gun mounted on his bike,
yeah,
who threatens dinner party guests with a sawn-off shotgun and has been offensive about National Treasure Dennis Potter. You know, that doesn't say eat these old noodles to me. Doesn't say
eat these old noodles. You up there, Stuart. The shotgun wasn't sawn off.
Oh, right, okay, I've exaggerated. Yeah.
Because that's illegal. It was a 12-gauge Lambert over and under.
Right.
It wasn't sawed off.
Okay, all right.
Wrong. Right. Where were we? Oh, yeah, what do I like to eat? Is that what? Yeah. I never really got to describe my dystopian outfit either, really, did I?
No.
Because you might have, like, I did years ago because I'd sworn never to wear evening dress until Palestine was free. And then
that really will hold the enemies of Palestine to account, won't it? They'll be thinking, when will we get to see Alexis Earle in evening dress?
Well, it became,
and how can we sort this out?
When I was invited to a lot of award ceremonies where it was, so I was forced to give up. But I thought one of the solutions.
Unfortunately, I was invited to a lot of award ceremonies, so I had to give up. That sort of his resolve failed.
Yeah,
very quickly.
I think I broke my pledge to the solemn pledge of the Palestinian people for the National Television Awards, which was black tie.
Yeah.
And also the Society of Motor Manufacturers and Traders Christmas dinner, I think I also betrayed the Palestinian people.
Were you doing a corporate for that? Was that a corporate gig?
I wouldn't do them. Right. But no, because I was a motoring correspondent.
Motor journalist, yeah.
Because I was a motoring journalist. And so I loved being a guest. No, and I did see, I mean, I think one year they had Alexander Armstrong. He was doing the corporate. I mean, extraordinarily shoddy piece of work that he provided for his, you know, 15 grand or something.
Yeah.
I remember. But what was it? Oh, yeah. So I thought one of the solutions at one point might be that rather than when I was trying not to wear evening dress, was that I could become a member of a kind of some disbanded kind of Eastern Europe, you know, kind of Austro-Hungarian regiment, like a kind of regiment of Uhlans or something. And I could wear their dress uniform rather than rather than evening dress. So I could come in the, you know, I'm in my blue, you know, patrol blues or whatever, my, you know, my dress uniform with the sabre.
Yeah.
You know, so I might wear like that. I might, yeah, that would go with the kind of bicycle cavalry thing. I could wear the uniform of the first Hussars or something, or Lancers.
When I was critically acclaimed about 10 years ago, I kept getting invited to awards ceremonies, and I sort of just didn't want to go. I went to the British Comedy Awards in about 1990.
I never went. Well, I wish. Actually, that's another arrogance thing. Sorry, I'll let you. Yeah. But I wish I'd gone to the Comedy Awards. They sounded fucking amazing, really. I mean, drunk and coked up.
Well, I went in about 1990 when I was on the team for On the Air, 91. And there were loads of people. It wasn't very nice, really. And then I didn't want to go again, and I didn't want to go to anything. And then one year, Comedy Vehicle got nominated, and I couldn't go because I was working. And then I think it won two things that year, and I felt like I'd let the people that worked on it down, you know, by. Then I won a BAFTA, but I went to that, but I got cut out. Me and Terry Pratchett got cut out of the TV coverage, and I think it's because I wasn't like crying, and I said that something like, you know, this is a bit random. Who knows whether anything's any good or not? We did the thing we wanted to do. I couldn't really. I don't have the sort of.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I don't believe in the validity of the judgment system enough to sort of really. Own it, you know. But then the second time it got nominated for British Comedy Awards, I wasn't working, and I thought I'd probably better go because all these people have worked on it. But then I didn't feel I could. I felt I needed some sort of protection, you know. So I bought this kind of costume of like a sort of Wild West kind of frontier tracker sort of thing, of a sort of buckskin jacket and bootlace ties and cowboy boots and stuff. And I thought, well, I'll sort of go as that. And then I thought I sort of won't look anything like what I normally look like, and I'll feel different in my head. But it still didn't work. I was so wound. Yeah, no, that was British Comedy Awards. It was the last one, actually. Yeah. They scrapped them after that.
Yeah,
they sort of did. They did what Keir Starmer's doing. They tried to please everyone in the end. The British Comedy Awards by having they started off as like quite a highbrow thing, and they had awards for radio scripts and things like that. And then towards the end, they ended up just having like. Things voted for by the readers of TV Quick, and then it was nothing by the end. It didn't have any meaning, so no one wanted to do them anymore. It started off at this big studio in LWT in the early 90s with film stars at it, and by the end, I was taken into some warehouse, you know, on the North Circular where it happened there, and it was all very strange. It was interesting having been at the beginning of it and at the end of it, you know. I can't face it.
It's like the Austro-Hungarian Empire. So it rose, you know.
Yeah.
Became and then was consumed by its own decadence, wasn't it?
Really? Yeah. Yes. Well, that's a very, very good way of looking at it. But again, the British Comedy Awards were like the Austro-Hungarian Empire. It's good to take away bullet points.
Maybe we should.
I mean, to be honest, I thought that when I went to the first ones in 1990, I thought. This is going to end like the Austro-Hungarian Empire. I can see the way it's going. You know, when someone got a big snake. One year, about 1995, I saw this on telly. Some idiot brought along a massive python, you know, like a 30-foot-long snake on the stage.
Yeah.
And it was sort of wriggling around and falling off, and all the TV people on coke were laughing at it. And I felt so sorry for the snake. It shouldn't have had to be at that, you know, and be... prodded about by people, and I just thought I don't want to be part of a thing where a snake is sort of frightened for the entertainment of I can't remember who brought it. It had been prearranged on some level, but it was and it wasn't having a good time, the snake. I mean, and sure. That's what I feel like at those awards. I feel like that snake at them. The last one I picked it up on the telly, which was funny. There was a category King of Comedy, and it was voted for by the public. And they said, "Oh, we've put you in for that." And I went, "Well, I don't want to be in. I don't want to be voted for by the public as King of Comedy, because obviously lose it anyway. Because it's just weight of numbers, isn't it? And it's who's got social media. So obviously Jack Whitehall won it. You know, ridiculous. I mean, he's all right. It's not a King of Comedy, is he, on anyone's terms.
No,
it's not. I'm sure he wouldn't even think that himself. But you just have to go, I can't accept this. It should go to any number of people. It's crazy. And what I also noticed at them is, you do your little well-brought-up lower-middle-class boy thing at them. You make sure you do your little speech and you go, of course, all the other people were good as well, and I don't know why we've got this. And no one does that anymore. People don't even mention you. You know, they just sort of people act like they deserve things. You know, it's so,
do they?
So weird. Yeah. Anyway. But who knows when they'll... Yeah. Come around again. I was hoping he might win some awards for the King Rocker film because it had helped to shift it. But everything's in flux now because it used to be this thing that has to have a cinema release, but now no one knows how any, because nothing's had a cinema release.
You see, so again, no one knows. Another one of my, you know, because I won all the awards early on apart from a BAFTA. I've got a fifth share in a BAFTA by the young ones, but I never won one myself. But I won all the others, including an Emmy. I was very dismissive. I wouldn't go.
I wish I could, you know, I was young when, you know, I was young when Acid House was happening and Britpop, you know, and I wouldn't join in with, I went out with a journalist at the time who worked for the Melody Maker in the Britpop time. And I just never went to any of those things. And I now look back on it, I think probably should have had some fun.
Again, it's part of being like, us in it, really, probably just me and you, but that we didn't, you know, it's a vital part of our learning process that we didn't go to Acid House, you know. This is going on endlessly. Haven't you got to go and do the kids' lunch or whatever? But
I have actually in a bit.
You know, the idea of the comedian is outside. I mean, I wanted to, one of the things I know you think, I think you did a kind of self mocking thing once about, you know, Indian shamans and true, and it's both true and not true about the comic being, you know, I mean, about the comic being the kind of conscience, the fool that, you know.
Well, you know what that was? That was about 20 years ago. I really was just thinking, what is the point of this? And partly I was annoyed because I was with one of these big management companies and I didn't like how everything was owned by them. You know, you ended up having to pay them for their publicity and you had to rent all their stuff and they promoted you at a loss at the same time live, and then you would have that money taken off whatever you'd earn for writing or radio. And it was all, and I remember being really hating all that. But of course, that's how everything works. And that's what Ken Loach's film about The Delivery Man is about, that how they have to rent the van from the company and pay the insurance from the insurance company that has a partnership with the company they're delivering for. And they're self-employed, but they are used like a worker. You know, basically, big comedy management 20 years ago was just 10 years ahead of the curve of the way the whole world was.
Yeah.
But I really got disillusioned and I didn't understand what the point of anything was. And then when I started reading about this idea of the clown as a shaman, I think it made me think, it gave me a bit of pride.
I remembered that. I mean, it's profoundly true and has given me a kind of self-justifying motivation to...
Yeah,
carry on as well, really. But I think it is true. That's what the best of us should do, and that's why I felt so disappointed with so many people in the last 5 years, really. But let's not get into that now.
You know what? They've grown up in a different sort of world. That's the problem. You know, I was backstage once in a circuit gig, and a guy was saying to me, a comedian who I don't know if he was like a comedian or a TV presenter or what. I don't know. He was saying, oh, my brother works for Apple, actually. He's high up in Apple. And I assumed that he wouldn't like Apple. So I said, oh, yeah, one of my relatives works for Apple. You know, it's difficult for him because he does feel bad about it. But on the other hand, you know, and he did understand what I was on about. Why would you feel bad about Apple? Then I realized that his brother was in the sort of PR wing of Apple and had actually been in touch with me a couple of months previously and had said, we'd like you to appear on a podcast that Apple do. You do it at the Apple headquarters and you take questions from the public. and then it goes on as a podcast through Apple.
Yeah.
And I went, oh, right. Do I get paid for it? No. Do I have any say in the edit? No. But you get paid for it, Apple? Well, yeah. Well, I'm not doing it. I don't have any say in it, and I don't have any say in the edit, and I don't get paid for it. And he seemed to talk to me like he was doing me a favor for allowing me to go on an Apple podcast. And in the end, the exchange ended with him saying, I understand that appearing on an Apple podcast does not chime with your brand, right? And it was like, I wasn't allowed to have a feeling or an opinion for itself. Everything was about positioning yourself and the perception, you know, and I just thought, yeah, they've just grown up in a different world. And that I noticed Martin Scorsese has just written a piece for an American film magazine about his dislike of the word content being applied to art. And I did a show called Content Providers because 10 years ago I was in a gig at an Irish festival and I got a phone call. And someone went, we'd like to have some of your content for our phone company's app. And I went, what? We noticed you're appearing at the So and So Festival, and we'd like some content from you. I said, "What do you mean? I never heard it described as that before. Content. That what I was producing was content." And I said, "Oh, I haven't got any content." And I didn't even know what they meant. You know, but they've grown up in that world, so it's different for them. Yeah. We sound like people talking about how it's important to make your own walls or something, or do have to know how to do dry stone walling, or, you know, it's really, but there are loads of great young people out there doing the thing that you help to reposition, you know, and they're doing it in a tradition that you would recognize, but you have to get through a sort of smoke screen.
Yeah. Well, good. Well, you know more about that than me. I think we should stop at some point, especially because you...
I don't want to stop because I don't think you have any real enthusiasm for these, and I'm enjoying trying to keep it going against your will.
Like they shoot horses, don't they? What are you saying, Talal?
I'm sorry to break it to you guys, but this is content, what we do.
Oh, right.
The podcasts, right. The bike rides, that's technically
this is content. What even is talking about content, content?
Yeah. So that was my interview with Stewart Lee, and this really is after the recording now. And one of the reasons that Stewart has been going around the podcasts, and we should, we should help him out in this degree, is that he has been primarily plugging his new film, King Rocker. And I've seen it. It's a really fascinating meditation on fame. Passing of time, and I think talent, and it's really interesting to see Stewart branching out. I don't know whether he's done documentaries before, but it's certainly interesting seeing that ferocious intelligence applied to a documentary. So maybe we will see more of that in the future. So King Rocker is available on Now TV, and you can find out more if you go to kingrockerfilm.com, and we will also put up a link. Cheers. This has been the Alexi Sale podcast, edited and produced by Talal Karkouti. Music by Tarbouche Records. Thanks to Anthony Overton for the sound mixing and to Audio Boom for hosting us. Don't forget, you can check out my lockdown bike rides on our YouTube channel. Just look up Alexi Sale. That's it. Thank you. Bye.